If classical music regularly accounts for 7 or 8% of all records sold in Britain, back in 1973, Roxy Music and Bryan Ferry must have accounted for at least a measurable percentage. Three albums in 1 year, two from Roxy and Bryan's debut solo album. Through the decade of the 70s, Roxy Music managed to walk the thin line that separates fashion from fad. They're now one of the most revered British groups of that decade. They managed to survive a 3-year gap and came back strong in the early 80s. For Bryan Ferry as a solo artist, it's been 7 years between discs. Why has it taken so long? Why 3 years since the Roxy Music Avalon album?
I find that I always need to kind of escape from music for a while after a long bout of touring to kind of recharge the batteries and stuff. Otherwise, the whole process of making music becomes too automatic, you know?
Do you find it's easier to make a new record as one person than a group?
No, I wouldn't say it was easier. It's different in as much as you have a kind of more or less infinite roster of musicians that you can work with, which is a kind of very fortunate position to be in. But sometimes it makes it difficult, in as much as you're moving from one country to another so you can work with Mr. X or whatever. And so logistically it becomes kind of difficult.
Did you feel a sense of shared enthusiasm at the very beginning of Roxy Music?
Oh, yeah, you do. You know, when you're trying to make your mark initially, it's a very exciting time, and usually you're kind of poor and you're living in everybody else's pockets, and yeah, it's a very much a shared thing. And it's a very exciting time, but you can't really live like that all the time, you know. Obviously, you change. And your music, I guess, has to change a bit with you, too.
If we may look back at that first record and Virginia Plain, the first single, you're more censorious now. You take care at what you let out and what you don't.
Yeah.
At that time...
I think people expect that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. At the time, at the beginning, did you just want to get it all out there and not really inhibit yourself so much?
Oh, sure, because, I mean, I remember doing two and possibly even three records. I can't really remember in my second year. And, yes, it was just a case of having an idea and doing something, you know, just doing it.
Well, in those days, nobody was expecting anything, of course. Yeah, and there you suddenly arrived with not just Andy and Phil and Brian Eno and the others, but also, of course, with the team that went into the appearance of it all, with Nick DeVille and Anthony Price,
right.
Of course, doing the costuming.
Yeah.
How did you sit around and decide those early album covers?
I think we just sort of argued a lot. I would, and Anthony was very important, obviously, and still is involved, you know. I don't know, really. An idea or a bee in my bonnet about a certain kind of icon or something. For instance, with the first cover, I wanted to do something which was like a cheesecake advertising image, like the sort of pin-up girl that had been used in America a lot, say through advertising motor cars or Pepsi Cola, or, you know, just a sort of standard pin-up thing.
There was a year when you did three albums. That was 1973. Mm. I don't know what brand you're smoking now, but isn't it true that Do the Strand, which was from For Your Pleasure in that year, was actually named after the cigarette and not the street?
Yeah, it was a combination job, as usual with lyrics. I used to try to be clever and rope in as many references as possible, but that was a great image and a great advertising campaign, that whole Do the Strand and the guy with the trench coat on the bridge or whatever.
And yet...
One of the best records as well, I think, that we ever made, I thought. Tours used to drive me crazy. I mean, used to get so bored, you know, and you must have been on a tour where you've seen that, you know, the most exciting part of it, or should be, is the 1 hour or so on stage, you know, that evening. The rest of the day is travelling, and it's really is awful. And to try and make the whole thing more of an escape, more of a fantasy, and more bearable, yeah, we used to kind of dress up. And, yes, it was kind of it made the thing much more interesting for us to do all that, you know. But I guess it lost us some kind of credibility, I think. You know, for a few years, people really wouldn't, I think, take the music that seriously or whatever. Maybe they still shouldn't. But it used to be a matter of some concern to us, I think.
Well, it was the glam rock era, 73-74. The fact that you lasted was a testimony to your playing and singing skills. But
dogged determination.
Let's face it, a lot of people who were dressed flashily did not last that time. Your one touted mistake, let's see if you agree, was when you did the gaucho routine.
It was about 10 years ahead of its time. I curse Anthony to this day.
And yet the great success was probably when you put on the dinner jacket. It fit, didn't it?
Yeah, it was another uniform, of course. And they were all kind of uniforms, you know. And that was a sort of Cunard cruise type look. It's very much a kind of standard uniform thing, you know, that people wear, you know. And it was so successful that it became a bit of an image prison, actually, you know. And sometimes it's very hard to break out of something if it is so right.
You yourself made early promotional films, really, when especially you released your first solo album, These Foolish Things. You made films, I believe, for both The Hard Rain's Are Gonna Fall and the title track.
Right, yeah, we did them both in one afternoon. It's actually in the Roundhouse in London. And those were the days. It was just very straightforward, very simple, and you know, once again, fun to do. People running around in drag. A lot of people don't know to this day that Eric Bowman, the photographer on some of the album covers, was the pianist in Billie Holiday drag on the title track, and also he was one of the girls in the Hard Rain's chorus too. So we were gender bending ourselves in those days.
And enjoying making the films rather than considering it a chore.
Yeah. And one of the best ones we did was before that even, in 72, which was the remake remodel track from the first Roxy Music album. We did that at the Royal College of Art Film School. It was one of the nicest ones to this day, I think, that we ever did.
What made that one work?
I don't know, just the fact that, I don't know. It was a video thing as opposed to on film, and looked very kind of modern, you know. I suppose the costumes helped a lot, yeah. And just the whole look of it was quite new looking and still looks kind of extraordinary enough, you know, to be interesting today, I think.
Stranded, the third album, when Eddie Jobson appears in place of Eno, the departure of Eno. It was nicely theorized by one of your friends that there wasn't room in the band for two non-musicians. Do you think that's a fair way of putting it?
Up to a point. I think it got to a stage where I think Bryan wanted to do more things as he became more interested in the idea of playing. Because at the beginning of Roxy, he'd been sort of mixing the sound and then treating the instruments that the other people were playing, you know, through his synthesizer. And I guess it was time for him to sort of move on in a way, because he was too constricted within the groups, what he could do. It proved to be the right thing for him and for everyone, actually.
Stranded may have benefited from some pop ethos, because it was the first number one Roxy Music album, and it was a tremendously successful tour, and indeed one which a lot of people still look back on.
Yeah,
with great
Eddie Jobson was very good on stage, and I liked the thing of having a third sort of soloing instrument, you know, with the violin. Which was a it's getting very bad. That's what happens to you after all. So yes, it was. It's an enjoyable tour.
And Street Life was a hit single for you, so you had that to stay in the public eye. With the mention of the pointless passing through Harvard or Yale. And then another time, another place, and you really go mainstream by appearing with Twiggy, Smoke Gets in Your Eyes, as indeed Smoke Gets in Your Eyes this very moment. Was there any...
I had to be dragged onto all of those shows, as you might imagine.
And you had almost a multiple audience. You were a nice boy, the acceptable face of pop music for that BBC One audience. And, of course, with
my
Roxy...
My greatest acting role.
And with Roxy, certainly the sleeve of country life, for example, it was still the rebellious lad.
Yeah.
So two images, really.
Yeah, it was two careers, very much so. And I managed to keep that going for a while, and then it just got to be too much, I suppose, you know, too much to do. Because then you find that, oh, well, you want to try and live a life as well, and that all work, no play makes Bryan a dull boy or whatever. And so I just found I didn't want to work at that crazy, you know, speed for the rest of my life, because otherwise I would have no life to lead at all. And therefore the music would, after a while, die probably, because you'd really have to try and find some sustenance, you know. And
it was a five-year period where you were just batting them out there, as we look back in retrospect, we can see that. And were you doing it just for the excitement of getting your ideas heard? Was there some kind of just, approval you were getting out of it, or what?
Just to try and make money, I think. No, it was just trying to do a kind of a wide body of work. I mean, I really had discovered this kind of medium to work in, and I really had a lot of things I wanted to do, and so I just did them, you know, one after another.
Was it inevitable that you would run out of old favorites to do, or did you just decide, I don't want to do this anymore?
I decided I didn't want to do it anymore at that point. I think in the future I probably will do, you know, other songs. I just felt I guess I'd done enough of that, and wanted to, you know, to get more involved in writing again. There's nothing worse than being known for somebody who does great cover versions or something, you know. Because for me, always the work I've written myself has been the most important part of my output, you know. And I felt to some extent all those other records were helping to pay for that, because they weren't selling in America, for instance, you know, the Roxy records or the solo ones for that matter. So to make a living, I felt I had to sell more, you know.
Love Is the Drug is the only one that went in America as a single.
Even then, it was just a kind of what you call a turntable hit or something.
In the second half of the 70s, you did stop doing the solo cover versions like In Crowd or You Go to My Head, and you did the In Your Mind album, original material. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This Is Tomorrow was the first people heard of that. This was your solo debut of your own stuff. Was it one that you were happy with?
My least favorite album of all, that one. And I think it was just the chemistry of the players. It didn't quite work for me. It was just one of those things. But I quite like some of the songs from it, in fact. But it was something not quite right. It just didn't quite gel properly. But can't win them all.
You had a 3-year break from Roxy Music. During that break, Andy Mackay had his great success with Rock Follies. Phil Manzanera did Diamond Head. Did you ever feel responsible to them, we've got to do another album together, I owe it to them? Or was it just an indefinite vacation?
Yeah, it was just a kind of a breathing space, I suppose, you know. But at no point did I think any of us feel like we felt obliged to make another Roxy album or whatever. I certainly didn't feel I owed it to anybody to make one. No, I was out to sort of, you know, just didn't feel right to do it until it was right to do it, you know. sometimes you feel you have to go out and live a bit and sort of see a bit of the world. Or I think, I can't remember if that was when I was living in America for a while. Yes, I think it was. And the next album I made in Switzerland, in fact, which is the Bride's Trip there. It was after that that we made the next Roxy thing, which was Manifesto.
Well, people tend to think a pop star's life is easy, full of success, and yet there you had a disappointment. And the first single for Manifesto, Trash, probably the only Roxy Music single that stiffed. How do you take setbacks like that? Do you ever think it's over now?
I guess so, yes. I mean, you don't. It's not very pleasant. No. One is human, and if you spend time and effort to making something, you hope it's going to work. And it makes you appreciate when things do, hit it off as well.
Well, as they then did, because the cavalry charged in and Dance Away proved to be your best-selling single, I believe. That was one of the year's 10 biggest sellers. Angel Eyes, also a top 5 single from that album. And then into a great golden period for Roxy with 2 number 1 albums. And, of course, Flesh and Blood generating 3 hits. And I'm wondering if those 2 cover versions on that album weren't perhaps a last attempt to get some American recognition, because they were of American classics, Midnight Hour, and then The Birds, 8 Miles High.
Well, they, I think it was just such a good feeling, probably, when we were doing Flesh and Blood. I just felt that, it was all kind of quite open, let's try this, let's do this. And so we did a couple, for the first time, we did a couple of songs that hadn't been written within the group. And they were fairly successful.
You also had that lovely song, Oh Yeah, on the radio.
Yeah.
Beautiful number. And then one of those songs was taken and included in a film, Times Square, same old scene.
Oh, right.
Did you ever see that film?
Unfortunately, yes.
Finally, you had your long missing number one single with Jealous Guy, a tribute to the slain John Lennon. And that was one you almost had to be persuaded to put down on record, wasn't it?
Well, we thought there'd be a lot of flack, in as much as we seemed to be cashing in on that sort of tragedy. But it was a song that I'd kind of had intended to do, some years before. I always seemed to have a kind of list of songs, which if I heard a song and thought, oh yes, I really would like to do that one someday, I'd write it down or something. And that was one was very much high on the list of things I wanted to do.
After Jealous Guy goes to number one, the next Roxy Music album was Avalon. And almost continuing, ironically, in the musical mood established in Jealous Guy into that subtler, moodier realm. Is that the musical world in which you now dwell?
The netherworld. Yes, that's down in the catacombs. I don't know. It's difficult for me to say. It's a kind of... I suppose Avalon had a sort of seductive air about it, which I quite like. It had a very nice texture to the sound.
Now that you are about to release this latest solo album, we realize that it's been nearly 7 years since your last solo record. Has it been a diminution of desire, as well as being more critical of your own work, which has kept you from doing this?
Well, no. I mean, I really see Avalon as the last record I made. So I don't really think of it as a 7-year span. I see it as as 3 years. And to me, that doesn't really seem that long. And I always want the thing to be right, and I more so now than ever before. I don't really want to put something out unless I like it, you know.
Well, it's now again been 3 years since a Roxy album. Are you even thinking about one yet? Are you just wrapped up in finishing this one?
Well, I'm wrapped up with finishing this one, but I don't actually think there'll be any more any Roxy albums. Which I think Avalon was probably a good one to bow out with.
Thank you.